Come on, you looked it up. Anybody else? The squeeze. Yeah, everybody's like, no. I'm looking at you, Ms. Shriver. Come on, the squeeze. Come on, man. It's interesting that that song came to mind in this sermon. It's not because I went to prom last night that I did a Temptation song. That's not it. It's not because Byron went to the Hard Rock and had a beautiful dinner the other night. That's not the reason why. It's not because, and let me say this, we've got to remind ourselves something. This is not the sermon. Allow the Holy Spirit to convict you. Don't convict yourselves. Meaning a lot of times you're going to hear me preach a sermon, and as soon as I talk, I mean, some of you get that little nervous feeling, and you start kind of, you know, squiggling around in your seat because you feel like, is he preaching at me? I see all of you. So I'm looking at all of you. I do heavily turn to the right. That's just because that's the way I am. But all of you, this sermon is not just to, God's word doesn't go out to always convict. A lot of times we feel like, oh, I'm not going to read that, or I can't receive that because it's convicting. Listen, sometimes we just have to honor and know who God is, okay? And so the reason why this sermon came to be, the title is Good Versus Evil, Deity Over Desire, is because we are in a time that we call Lent. All right? I don't know if you've looked that up or if you know that. We don't traditionally go through all the Ash Wednesday and all those things, and we do all the things, but hey, you can turn the slide there. Good Versus Evil, Deity Over Desire. Here's what Lent is: a time to remember and honor. Now, most of you are going to say, what is Lent? That's the time we have to give up something, right? A teacher friend of mine the other day, I was trying to give everybody cookies. Because we had I went to this place. It's my favorite place now. It's called The Stuffed Cookie. It's in Valrico, right next to Bubba Q's. And they have a wonderful assortment of cookies. And I bought a dozen cookies. I'm not going to tell you how much that cost, but I bought a dozen cookies. And we decided I was going to share them with my administrative staff. And I was like that. And my principal, who is my boss, but also my buddy, she looked at me and I said, well, which one are you going to choose? And she said, I'm not choosing one. I'm going to try all of them. So we created the first, and I don't know if we can put this down, but the charcuterie board. So we created a charcuterie board and cut them all into many little slices. And you could just sample cookies. And it was wonderful. And this one teacher, I'm looking at her, I'm like, aren't you going to try any? She's actually not a teacher, she's an administrator. And I said, are you going to try one? And she goes, no, I gave up sweets for Lent. And I said, I gave up giving up for Lent. I've done that a long time ago. And we sit there, and listen, here's the reason why we, whatever you've learned, or here's the reason why we look at the 40 days, and it's the 40 days of the temptation of Christ. And you're sitting here going, okay, why do we remember that? We remember that because we need to understand His perfection. And realize I'm saying this to understand His perfection is not me blasting your imperfection. The law was given so that we would have a litmus of our comparison of what we are not going to be able to achieve. In the Old Testament, the law was given and they said these things and these things and these things. God knew good and well you weren't going to do all of those things. You weren't going to be able to, but you need to strive for that. And so as we look at the 40 days of the temptation of Christ, and I'm not going to go through them. You can go in the Gospels. We're not even going to be there today. But what we're going to do is we're going to remember how perfect God is. And in our imperfection, how we can strive to be more like Him. That's the point of us. I used to think, and I'll be honest with you, I used to think, you know, as a church person, we went out knocking on doors. I've done the faith outline and gone over to other people's houses I didn't know. We look a certain way. We dress a certain way. We sing a certain way sometimes and all these things. And we do all of this so people can see that we're Christians. That's not what they're supposed to be seeing. They shouldn't look at you because you have a Christian shirt on and a Christian hat on and a cross around your neck. They need to see the actions of your life and know who leads you. If we are introducing people to each other, we're wrong. We're supposed to be introducing them to Christ. And so when we think about the temptation of the 40 days, Jesus was perfect. He was and is, and He always shall be. He did, as we look at Easter and we move up to the Holy of Holies, and it travels us the 40, it's actually 46 days. It leads us up to the Thursday before the crucifixion. As we look at all that, let's remember who He was, who He inspired us to be. Inspired. I don't know what inspires you. Sporting events inspire me, right? I watch a great play. ESPN, the top 10, you know, POD, play of the day, those things. They get me energized, and they do that. Marketing is amazing. That they set you up and they show you something, and you're like, wow. Y'all all know the K-Tel commercials and all the ones that used to be on TV, and it would be something like, whoever thought of that egg slicer is amazing, right? We would go to the flea market, Auburndale flea market yesterday, and they had egg slicers galore, but they didn't have a good old-fashioned potato slicer like Kimberly was looking for that you just push down. They all want to slice them up like eggs or some kind of fruit core, apple core, but just an old-fashioned. Listen, people create gadgets, and it's amazing how many of us buy them. The gentleman who decided, and I don't remember the year, but made millions of dollars when he labeled a rock and called it your pet rock. And people bought him, and you're thinking, oh, yes, he's a millionaire on a rock in a box that you called your pet rock. They market this. I remember, y'all remember when Yamaguchi's or whatever that thing, what was that thing called? Yamaguchi, right? What? I hear names out of y'all. What are y'all saying? I don't know what you're saying.
Tamagotchi.
Yamagotchi, whatever. It's that little critter. And you're thinking, that's the dumbest little thing. It's a little critter, and it was on a little thing, and if you didn't feed it at a certain time, it died. That sounds immature. I was the warrant officer flying and the battalion commander, and I was sitting there, and he said, what are you doing, Chief Humphrey? And I was feeding my little guy so he wouldn't die. I'm a grown officer in the United States Army. He's like, what is that? I'm like, he's hungry. I gotta feed him, sir. Listen, they market junk, and we buy it. God's word, through the temptation of his son, marketed absolute perfection and obedience and following God the Father, and some of us don't buy it. What? It doesn't make sense. So let's look at our understanding. Deity over desire, good versus evil, the temptations in our lives and how we're supposed to approach them. If you have your Bibles, don't turn to the Gospels, but turn to the book of James. I'm on page 1919 for my brown Bible followers who don't have theirs with them. Page 1919. Good versus evil, evil over desire, Lent, 40 days of temptation. How many of you are tempted? Come on, don't be like, yeah. I can't pay the bills this month. Ooh, I need that. That's nice. Man, I'm a man of one. Ooh, look at that. I had a pastor one time back in Copper's Cove, Texas, and he told me this about being temptation or the lust of the eyes. He would say that if you see a good-looking, as a man, if you see a good-looking woman walk by, and you take a second look, that's temptation that's led you into an evil desire and lust. He says, so make sure you look really long and hard the first time so you don't have to look back. Listen, we are tempted constantly. We're tempted to do the right or wrong. And listen, for some of us, we think when I hear the word temptation, I'm not a good person. I haven't killed anybody. We're tempted. And sometimes it's just tempted not to listen. God gives you a command. Listening. We're tempted not to be in the gathering. We're tempted to forsake God. We're tempted to not be obedient. We're tempted not to call somebody. We're tempted not to write the note. Listen, temptation is driving us away from Him. It's not the desire to know Him. God wants us to know Him and be in relationship with Him. Here's the blessing. James chapter 1 verse 12 says this. Blessed is a man who perseveres under trial. Because when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who what? Love him. Blessed is the man, the Beatitudes, if you look in the Sermon on the Mount. The Beatitudes are blessed is the man who perseveres under what? Trial. By definition, you're going to be under trial. Your relationships, your life, your everything you do is going to be under some type of trial. Some different levels of trial. Some need hard trials to get them refined. Some need a little bit of a trial to get you refined. If you ever watch the sword-making show, Forged in Fire.
Amen.
Forged in fire. Great show. And listen, the hardest thing for them to do is to know exactly how much fire and how hot to get that blade or that metal before they cool it in the water.
Oil.
They do it in water and they have to one time and it messes it up. Remember the guy? And they call that something when you do that. I forget.
Quench
it. Look at that, my brother's making swords at home. There you go. But the whole thing is knowing how much. And I'm not telling you how much you can handle. When you lose a loved one or you're going through something really difficult, people will always ask me, how much can I handle? I don't know that. God knows that. How much should you handle? I don't know that. All I know is how much you should handle without Him is nothing. I know who to turn to. He says, blessed, because when he has stood the test, when you have stood the test, you will what? Receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. When you are in your temptation, your trial, your first focus shouldn't be your plight or your struggle or your worries or your woes. It should be the love of God. That's easier for me to say than it is for you to do. I know everything's going wrong in your life, but God loves you. I'm dealing with a lost marriage. I'm dealing with this, and I've got a child doing this, and the bills are here, and they're telling me this, and the law's here. Love the Lord God with all your heart. I mean, it kind of sounds like an easy solution, but easier said than done. True? Because you're in the midst of the trial. The crown of life that God has promised to those who love Him. Because He first loved you. He loved you so much that He gave His what? His only begotten Son. And here's what I have to remind you. There are two. I said good versus evil. God, deity over desire. Desire says this in the same passage as James wrote, well done, Samuel. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. Old country song, why me, Lord? Right? A lot of us in the middle of our struggles and our worries and our desires and they're driving us crazy. We will blame Him first, the absolute perfection of love, and we're going to turn on Him rather than turn to the truth that it's the world and the flesh that's letting us down. Not God. I used to be kind of sad for people that didn't want to be in the church. Sad for people that didn't want Jesus Christ. Listen, it sometimes makes me mad. And here's why. He perfectly loved them. He created them and desires to be in relationship with them. And guess what they're doing? They're not believing. No, they're rejecting my Lord and Savior. And their rejection is not going to make Him any lesser. That's where I have to come to the truth and realization. His rejection, people rejecting our church doesn't make us less a church. People not coming does not make us less a house of God, a body of Christ, a family of believers. It doesn't change that whatsoever. Because God is not tempting me, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does He tempt anyone. 40 days as Jesus is in the desert. 40 days, guess who's tempting Him? Not the Father, but Satan. If you in your moment, and Pastor Kimberly used to say it in a way that just grossed me out.
Oh, yeah.
And I'll say it because I'm not afraid to. When people look at things like pornography with younger girls or something, or you're a guy and you're looking for something younger when you're shopping, listen, you're looking at someone's child. You're looking at a father and a mother's child that raised that child, that loves that child, that was created by God. That is just disgusting that you would look that way. God doesn't tempt you, nor anyone, and never has, not even His Son. And He knew how that would turn out, for He Himself was God, full deity and full man at all times. But each one is tempted when what? By his own evil desire. We like to play the blame game. Pastor, it wasn't me, it was him. It was them.
Devil made me do it.
That little right here, got the red one and the white one right here, and they're talking to me, like in the cartoons. I love bringing our students in when they've done something wrong. Boy, you talking about, y'all don't ever want to go to and military with them, because they'll tell all your secrets real quick, but they'll give it up. To the point where you, hey, I saw you smoking that. No, I wasn't. I really wasn't. Best excuse I've heard all year. I said, son, I saw you blow smoke out of your mouth. Sir, right before you walked in, someone blew it in my mouth. We got other problems if that's true, but listen. Don't blame everyone around you. Here's what's the craziest, saddest part about understanding. And it took me as a pastor, as a man of God, to realize that when I moved back into my own hometown. A prophet is not welcome in his own hometown. Didn't know what that meant. I didn't even know that scripture kind of, oh, that's just Jesus and those guys. They're going to accept me. Don't accept Jesus, but they'll accept Randy. Let me tell you. All of those people that in that moment that you're going to blame for your struggle and your strife, they're not going to help you through it when you're really going through it. As soon as you turn on that person, you blame them, guess what? They are no longer part of your circle. They're not supporting you. God, listen, here's a great grace story. When you blame God, He's okay. When you're mad at God, He's okay. When you shout at him and scream, I tell people when you've lost a loved one and they come to me, why? I said, don't talk to him. He's got big shoulders and a great big heart and he loves you. Each one is tempted by his own evil desire. We look at our children a lot of times. I'm in a mess. You've got yourself in the mess. Look around you now. Who's to blame? Byron, who worked in the jail for 30 plus years or all through the all that he did dealing with criminals. Guess what? When they get in that cell, guess who's with them? A lot of times it's just them. They're by themselves. A lot of people have a come to Jesus moment when they're by themselves. Because they look around, I'll blame. I guess it was me this time. By his own evil desire, he is dragged away and enticed. By the definition, to be dragged away means you're probably going off kicking and screaming and fighting. It's not what you really want. That is the misconception here. The evil desire that leads you into sin and temptation that overtakes you is not what you truly want. It is that which satisfies a need for a moment. But it's not a want that's going to change your life or lead your life. People who go into drug addictions, they don't look at it and go, hey, I want to throw my life away. This sounds like the right path. They get into it, it entangles them, and it's dragging them into a place and enticing them into a lifestyle that they didn't want to be a part of. But now that they're in the middle of it, what are they going to do? Then after the desire is conceived, it gives birth to what? Sin. That's the separation. I don't want you to go, which list of sins are we talking about today? I want you to look at sin as one thing, the separation between you and God. When you're being dragged away and you're being enticed, you're being dragged away from a perfect, loving relationship with the Father. That's what you're being dragged away from. Why did Jesus not succumb to temptation? Because he could not be separated from the Father. That's why there was no sin. Because he could not. Absolutely, the attributes of the Trinity says they cannot separate all deity and all man. So therefore, he was absolutely perfect. He didn't get dragged away. He wasn't enticed. He didn't sin. It gives birth to sin. And when sin is full-grown sin, little sin, teenage sin, full-grown sin gives birth to death. You know what that full-grown sin is? It's the absolute rejection of Jesus Christ. That's full-grown sin. How do you know it's full-grown? Because it's the only one that's unforgiving. You can't, when people say blasphemy, oh, I heard that word. And listen, growing up, we heard that word. If you said the G and the other words together, you are going straight to the pits of the fiery hell that you could ever think of. Blasphemy is the absolute, complete, mature understanding of who God is and rejecting Him. Full-grown. When sin is full-grown, it fully is aware. When you stand before the judge and you say, were you fully aware of your actions? Yes, and I reject you, and therefore he goes, guess what? You have eternal death. So the good news in all that is this. If you're not fully conceived or conceiving the fact that Jesus is Jesus, and if you're not really completely throwing God to the wayside, and if you have some little inclination that he might be and he could be, then you're not at full-grown sin and you're not eternally damned right now. Dumb and dumber. It's always beautiful when you can throw a dumb and dumber quote into your sermon. hey, will you go out with me? Not, you have, well, do I have a chance to go out with you? You have one in a million chance to ever go out with me. There's hope. There's that one in a million. And listen, sometimes we have to be okay in the one in a million. What do I mean by that? They might know Jesus. I've shared Jesus with them. They've heard my testimony. I've planted that seed. You've given it an opportunity. At that point, you're still planting into something that's not fully grown, that is not eternally damned, that is not dead, and you still have hope. The desire of the flesh does not overcome God's great love. It was perfect. And it was perfected and given to us as an example and marketed by Jesus Christ. Verse 16 through 18 closes it this way. Whether your blessing comes from, if blessing comes from God, desires of the flesh and of the world, but gifted. Ooh. How many like gifts? It's my love language. It is. One of the things I started sharing with you years and years ago, if you've been around, right, Miss Betty? Man, they go to a yard sale, what are they looking to do? Get a gift for the pastor, right? Anything Gator, just buy it, right? Don't be deceived, my dear brothers. Here's the word of wisdom for today. Every good and perfect gift is what? From above. Coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. Wasn't, is, and always shall be the same. I sure wish he was. Loved me as much as he loved Moses and all those people he led out of Egypt. He is that God. I sure wish he loved me so much that he would do. He is that God. I wish so much that one day he would open up the gates of heaven and I could walk on the streets of gold. He is that God. Was and is and always shall be the same. And he's not changing. The world changes every day. First thing I do when I get up in the morning, I say my prayer, my feet hit the ground, I go and I get on the phone. How has the world changed today? Who's in? Who's not in? What's popular? Listen, for everyone in this room, there's a word or a term or something you said as a kid that meant no harm and no foul. But you say those same things today and you're like, what? I've had high schoolers tell me, I say something like, do you know what that means? I'm like, I thought I knew what it meant when I was like 10. And then they say the words that should never come out of anybody's mouth. Look in the Urban Dictionary. No, don't go there. Everything you've ever thought of that was okay is not okay to somebody. And that's the shifting and changing. I'm going to tell you something that's kind of offensive to some people. If your religion, if your faith and the faith that you're taught and the following and the directions of God that you're being taught, if they change, they're wrong. If you're part of a group that changes monthly, yearly, or every so often, it doesn't change with God. He chose to give you birth through the word of death. We just talked about death is sin. So birth is through the word of truth, through the love and the understanding of who Jesus is, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. First fruits. If you understand that in biblical context, it means the best. First fruits. When you go to a draft, I don't care which draft it is, NFL, baseball, basketball, I don't care, high school, college, Little League, right? Little League, that's how I say it. The first person picked is usually the best person. Well, let's wait around for, no, grab him. Get him off the chart because he's the best. When God calls you a first fruit, he's calling you the best. Jesus was perfect against sin and temptation because he is the best and he wants the best for you. That's the gift. Jesus was given as a payment for our debt. Yeah. Propitiation of our sin. Standing atonement for us. Substitutional atonement. All those theological things. But he was given as an example to be the gift so that we could see it marketed and lived out perfectly. Show it to me. He did. Believe half of what you see and none of what you hear. He gave us the Son. Well, he did what? Yes, he was tempted. Well, he never. Yes, he did walk as a man. He lived like, I don't know what y'all think, if it's some kind of like he floated around. He ate food. He was a man. When it was hot, he was hot. When it was cold, Jesus was cold. At any time, he could have said, it's hot. It's all cool now. Jesus, the Son of God, God in flesh, didn't have to walk around. He could have ridden on the perfect horse. A chariot could have come down. It had let Elijah ride into the heaven. Why couldn't he let Jesus ride around? He walked, talked, and lived a life so that we could see that example. So next time you feel like, woe is me, woe is you, because you're turning away from God. That's the woe. Stop where you are. Stop blaming God and start trusting Him. The evil desire and temptation in your life is born by you, not by God. God's gift is greater than your gain. Meaning this, whatever you think you're going to gain from not accepting or trusting Him pales into comparison to His great love for you. God is never furious about your ignorance. He doesn't go, oh. How many of us as parents have looked at our kids and go, why? How many of us have said and like within minutes just gone to that bubbling, we're like a volcano erupting, like, why did you just do that? Why did you not listen to me? I can tell you, if that's the way God the Father was, He's spending eternity in heaven going, why, you ignorant? He doesn't look at that. He's steadfast in His love and His promise and His commitment that through His Son, Jesus Christ, all of your sins are erased and the dead is paid. That's what He's doing. What breaks His heart, let me tell you. When Jesus went upon the cross and He said, Father, is there another way? Father spoke back to Him. No, there's no other way. He understood that. Why me, Lord? He understood. Why Him? Jesus, full deity and full man at all times, fully aware of what He was sent here to do. And He did it perfectly. We get a marching order from somebody who's in leadership or over us, and they say, go do this. And we're going, oh, I'll do it my way. Why don't we do it His way? Because that's the way that leads to eternal life. As we celebrate, remember, and commemorate Easter through the Lent, through the Holy of Holies, through all that we do, let's remember the gift was given so that you would be forgiven. Let's pray this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, thank You so much for Your blessings, Your gift. Lord God, I will ask on behalf of myself first. I ask for forgiveness for the times when I didn't listen so well. I'll say it nicely. Thank You for being perfect in Your love, even in the midst of my disobedience. Lord God, I pray this morning. I'm not praying for Your forgiveness, because that's given. I'm not praying for Your love, because that's a definition of Your attribute, perfection. I'm praying that we, as people, as the church, as parents, as boyfriend and girlfriend, in relationships, whatever our place, or whatever hat we're wearing at that moment, may we be a reflection of Your true grace and love. May we be able to look past our own ill-gotten gains or our own desires and allow people to focus on who You are and, more importantly, the gift that You've blessed them with. God, I want to say thank You this day for being so perfectly consistent. Lord, in my life, I like routine. You know that. And You love me routinely, but with great, great importance. This day, I say thank You. And this day, I say thank You for saving all my brothers and sisters. But this day, I ask You, Lord God, is You will use us in some way to flow outside of the four walls, to flow outside of our comfort zone, maybe even to flow out of our own understanding and flow further down the way or the river, Lord God, as we reach those who truly, truly need to know You. As long as they have breath in their lungs, they're not too far gone. even though the world may have thrown them aside or pushed them away and said that they're lesser or they don't understand or there's no possible way that this person could ever change. There's no way that God could save them. Lord God, in this understanding that we have, may we truly trust your word, not ours or anyone else's. As long as they have breath in their lungs and they can confess with their mouth and believe in their heart that Jesus Christ did go up on that cross and that he was crucified and he died and he went into a grave and he conquered death. He robbed that grave and he robbed it of its eternal understanding that Jesus is life. It's not death. I pray for those that don't trust and believe and have not yet received you. For may this be their day. May you purpose this day for someone today, Lord God. And it may not be in this building, it may not be in this community, it may not be in our city that we'll ever know or understand, but somewhere on this great, beautiful planet that you created for us, may someone this day come to a saving grace and knowledge of who you are. And Lord, I pray for them today. I don't need to know their name because you do. I don't need to know where they live or what they've gone through or where they're going because you do. And today I pray.